to my soul. You bring restoration.
Pray for Israel in this hour in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, as we speak to that nation, Shabbat Shalom, Lord, we speak peace over that nation. We pray for peace over that nation. We know that you're coming back for that people. Lord, the line of the tribe of Judah is going to return to Israel. It's going to return. Lord, we thank you, Lord Jesus. You are the Holy One of Israel. You are the Holy One of Israel. The Holy One of Israel, we thank you for what you're doing today. In Jesus' name. And just as you've spoken to us, church, you're saying to us this morning, you're saying to be blameless, to be holy, to be set apart. Lord, you're telling us this morning that we must prepare our garments as you've given us that vision of the angels that were sent, the angel that was sent to the churches to receive the scrolls as a report to what type of message was being preached in those churches. Is it a message that's preparing the church and their garments for that day of the Lord? And the angel of the Lord was taking those scrolls back to the Father to give a report of exactly what was coming. Was it pure worship? Was the worship going up undefiled? As the Bible says in the book of Psalms, who can stand on my holy mountain? Who can stand on my holy hill? Only those with clean hands and pure hearts. Hallelujah. Well, God is speaking about the garment today. Hallelujah. And I want us to focus on this garment. This is a wedding garment. This is a traditional Victorian style wedding dress. God is not coming back for a skimpy looking wedding dress. He's coming back for a traditional, a covered, a holy and pure garment. Hallelujah. He's not coming back for things that are undefiled in this hour. As we can see here from this traditional Victorian style wedding dress, it has the long shoulders, it is covered, it's covering the arms. It's got a traditional cover here where the head is being covered. It's completely covered and it comes with a long trail, a train that covers the back. This is the style of wedding dress that the Lord is looking for the bride that is preparing in this hour. He's not coming back for something that is defiled. He's not coming back for something that is of this world. He is coming back for something that is pure and holy. Hallelujah. The Bible says in the book of Revelation 16 verse 15, it says, behold, I am coming as a thief. Blessed is he who watches and keeps his garments clean, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. Hallelujah. This is talking to the church this morning. He is coming back for those that have made their garments ready. Hallelujah. Are we making our garments ready? Are we preparing ourselves? If we are not of this world, then we must prepare ourselves for that day of the Lord. Hallelujah. What is our attire? What is the attire that we are wearing? Preparing ourselves even for that day of the Lord. Hallelujah. And the Bible says in the book of Revelation, chapter 19, from verse 7, it says, let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. See, are we preparing as the church and preparing our garment for that day of the Lord? Are we truly preparing for that day of the Lord? Hallelujah. Because if the angel, as has been shown to us, has been sent to all the churches to find out what type of message is being preached, is it a message that's preparing the body of Christ for that day of the Lord? Is it a church that's preparing its garments spotless and pure? Hallelujah. See, if this garment has a spot, has a blemish, or even a wrinkle, he will not come for that church. He is not coming for a church that is wearing strapless uniforms. He's not coming for such a church. He's not coming for such a church, a filthy church. He's coming back for a pure and a holy bride. Hallelujah. So what is God saying to us today? If we look at the Bible, and we look at the book of Exodus, chapter 3, verse 5, it says, all of a sudden, Moses was walking past as he was taking his sheep, as he was a shepherd, taking his sheep daily through a safe place, through a common place, through a comfortable place, because it became a comfort zone to him. He knew that place. He didn't go out of that place because he knew it was safe to bring those sheep through that place. But as he was walking, he saw a burning bush, and he had to look a second time. And it even drew his curiosity to go towards the burning bush. Then all of a sudden, a voice came from that burning bush and said, Moses, Moses, says, take off your sandals because this is now holy ground. Hallelujah. What God is saying to us in this hour, into the church, he says, you might have been in your comfort zone in your church. You might have been in your common Christianity for what you were preached, how you were brought up. But God is saying now, it is holy ground. And he's sending his angels to the churches to see if that message is holy. Is it preparing your garment for that day of the Lord? Is it holy, undefiled worship with clean hands and pure hearts? And we are not lifting up our idols to another. Hallelujah. God is saying there is a change. There is a change in this hour. The Bible says in the book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 30, it says, when God overlooked such ignorance in the past, he is now calling all people to repent. Hallelujah. This is an hour of change. That means whatever message we were brought up on, if it was the prosperity gospel, if it was a lukewarm, compromised message, God is saying, now it must be holy, now it must be pure. Hallelujah. There is much going on and being said in this world at this time to justify your comfort zone. What is your comfort zone today? Is it the way you live? Is it the way where you live? Is it the way you dress? Is it the way you talk? Is it the movies you watch or the entertainment that you see? What compromise has crept into our lives today? Because God is saying there is a change in this hour, and it is a change because it now has become holy. Hallelujah. If we look at the book of Psalm, chapter 55, verse 17, verse 19. It says here, it says, God will hear and afflict them, even he who abides from of old, because they do not change, therefore they do not fear God. What is God saying to us as a church? We have made a commitment to him, but we are now changing the terms, meaning he is a holy God. And we have chose to change, but God is saying, no, there is a change in this hour. The church must change to my standards. His standards do not change. He is holy, he is holy, he is holy, and he is worthy to receive all praise and honor. Hallelujah. Just as we were reading before from the book of Revelation, only the Lamb of God who was slain on that cross was worthy to undo those seals. Only he was worthy. And God is saying to us, we better change. We better change. Otherwise, it says here, God will hear and afflict them. Meaning that church that will be left behind due to endure the tribulation. You will be afflicted during the tribulation. Amen. Those that have not made themselves ready will endure the tribulation. But those that are willing to change and say, God, we're going to now start to live by your holy standards. We're now going to start to live by what your currency is, not by what our currency is. Hallelujah. God is saying today, there must be change because it shows the lack of fear in the church in this hour. Oh, hallelujah. What I'm seeing now is that God is bringing an end time revival to this city, to the nations of the world. But we're not to focus too much. We're just to look to Israel and we're to stay pure and holy. Hallelujah. But I believe that from a remnant of people, God is going to pour out His Spirit in such a measure for the bride that has prepared itself in purity and in holiness. Let us look at that church. Let us look at the church, the beginning church. The book of Acts chapter 5 tells us of the story of Ananias and Sapphira, where they lied to the Holy Spirit and they were struck down dead because of such a thing. And it says here from verse 11, so great fear came upon the church and upon all who heard these things. When people of God will understand the glory that is now coming back to the church, they will also start to fear those things that will take place in the future. And though the hands of the apostles were many, signs and wonders were done among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch, yet none of the rest dared join them, but the people esteemed them highly. We are in an hour where this message is becoming too tough for many. It is becoming too tough for many because they know they can't. They fear coming in. And even the devils are going out and telling people, oh, keep clear of those people. Keep clear of those people. They're legalistic. They're legalistic. They're trying to address the sin in your life. But God is saying in this hour, no, He's saying you must change. If you do not change, you'll be afflicted and you will endure the tribulation. Hallelujah. But God is saying to those that will change, we must be on His terms. Hallelujah. We must be holy. We must be pure. See, there are many people going around and arguing this point at the moment between legalism and holiness, and they are two separate things. But many people are coming up with different occurrences, and I just want to read from Colossians 2 verse 14 and 15. It says, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us but was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, and he had it nailed to the cross. Hallelujah. And then we go down to verse 18. Let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility and worship of angels, introducing you into such things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up in his fleshly mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom all the body nourished and knit together by joints and ligaments grows with an increase that is from God. There are many saying they are hearing from God in this hour, but it's redirecting the Church of Christ away from the narrow path. And I'm here to say that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and His standard is holy. Hallelujah. And for those that have had the privilege to see the revival in Kenya will know that there has been a change. The church has been changed. The addressing is changed. They dress holy. Their worship is holy. Everything is holy. The community is changed and impacted by such a revival. Hallelujah. See, most of us, revival is more than just the manifest presence of the glory of God in our own lives. As desirable as it is, it must create change even in the community. See, merely seeking to experience God's presence is only self-focused. See, even in our worship, we try not to sing any songs that says anything about I, anything about us, but all about the fact that He is holy and He is pure. Hallelujah. because there is too much of the I and the us and the we where it should be all about Christ. Hallelujah. That's where the power is. That's where the power is in the old rugged cross at the moment. See, it says here, but we must be seeking to be changed by His presence and holiness. Take humility that produces repentance, the fruits of repentance, and a heart that is one with His heart. When we want to be one with Him, we must be transformed. We must be changed. On who He loves, we shall love. On who He forgives, we shall forgive. On who He showed mercy, so shall we. Hallelujah. A heart that is not wanting any to perish, but have eternal life. Hallelujah. This is what we're seeing in this hour. We want a revival that is going to bring change to this community. There must be change. Hallelujah. Many people are commenting on things and saying it's legalism, but they themselves have not noticed that the season is time to change. Hallelujah. And I'm here to tell you, you must change in this hour, because where God overlooks such ignorance, He's now calling all people to repent. Hallelujah. See, whenever we preach this message, there are two people that oppose this message. Those that don't want to be told that what they are doing is wrong. See, when you go to a doctor, and you go to a doctor with a sickness or something, you know there's a problem. When he tells you, you must change your lifestyle. When he tells you that you must stop eating this, and you must eat healthy, and you must do exercise, we don't like that. We would rather go to a doctor and he gives us a pill that we can take that can just fix the problem, then we can continue on with the way that we were living in our life. And so it is with the church. We want to hear a message like it's just going to be a pill to fix the problem without us bringing change into our lives. Hallelujah. The Bible says, a famous scripture, Matthew 6, verse 33. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, then everything else will change and be added unto you. Hallelujah. Are we willing to make that change? Hallelujah. Every single person I come across, I ask him this question. If you had 30 days to live, what would you change in your life? As they start to ponder on that, I said, well, I'll help you. First, you would get your life right with God, and then you would get it right in every other aspect of your life. Hallelujah. In relationships, in all things. And what I find is when people bring change in their life, God comes and blesses them such in a powerful way. Hallelujah. So that means when God comes along, He expects change. We must see change, not only in our own lives, but those around us. See, people want the blessings of God. They want the joy of God. They want the fullness of God. They want the healing of God. They want the provisions of God. They want the anointing of God. They want the revival of God. But often we don't want to be told that our sin is blocking the presence of God, and we must bring change in our lives. Hallelujah. See, opposition to holiness will come because flesh likes sin. Flesh likes you to stay in your comfort zone without making a shift or a change. But God is saying we must change. Hallelujah. We must go from our standards to now His standards. Hallelujah. See, when we sin, we tend to give blame to other people. We say, oh, it's the devil's fault. It's our neighbor's fault. It was my girlfriend's fault. It was my boyfriend's fault. Whatever the change is, we give blame to other people rather than taking responsibility. See, we don't like to be told those sins of what we cannot do. We don't like to be told, hey, sorry, you're living in a fornication relationship. Yet you're saying you're going to marry this person, but you're committing sin right now. No one likes to be told that, but he's my fiancé. I'm going to marry him in the future. No, they are not the standards of a holy God. We are in that time right now that we are also entrothed to the Lord, but we haven't been fully wed unto Him. So there is a holy sanctification period, and that's what God is saying into the church also. We don't like to be told, oh, we can't watch those TV programs, we can't play those video games anymore, we can't watch this or do this or change the way we dress. Oh no, we don't like to be told those things. See, most of us, would we do the things that we do in secret here on a Sunday morning? Because many of us do that. We come to church on a Sunday and it's all holy. But as soon as we go back to those very sins. But see, you wouldn't do anything here that you generally wouldn't do in the secret. But the defilement that has come into the church is many of those sins now have crept into the even church, where it's defiled the altar of God. And then there is a second group of people. There are those that are hungry for God, and they do not like their sin. They do not like their sin, but what they see is when they hear this message, they go, oh, I had a bad experience of that in my parents' church, or my parents bring him out, or so Joe Blogg, he thumped hell into me, or whatever. And they give all these excuses to say, I don't like that message. But what I can tell you that is pride in your life, hallelujah. Because you're not willing to change, because God is demanding there must be change in this hour. You are saying, I must change on my own terms. But God is saying he wants to see change, hallelujah. A change when you have the awareness of God, where you're at all with God and you all of a sudden start to change. See, that's what I'm seeing in revival. It's not something necessarily someone tells you. All of a sudden, as you start to bring your life into right standing with God, you get to the point that, hey, God is telling me to change. But he's not only just telling me to change here, he's telling me to do a complete U-turn with the way that I was directing and the way that I was going. See, to repent is to turn from that and turn the other way. But most of us just repent of a few sins, but continue to go down the path of the other sins. But God is saying, no, there must be a complete U-turn in this hour. There must be. See, legalism will bring death, but holiness will bring life. The problem is something that is just opposed to us from the outside, but has not had an inward conviction, will bring death. See, if I was to say to everyone, this is the standard, bang. Then all of a sudden, people would start to convert to the outward change without an inward conviction. But God is saying, he's speaking to each and every one of us, we must change from ourselves. We must stop doing those things that we used to, because we're now on another path. Because where God said he overlooked such stuff in the past, he's now calling all people to repent. Hallelujah. See, we must have an inward conviction. Holiness is God empowered. Holiness is when God himself changes and transforms our nature. Of holiness is not just a set of rules and negotiations, but holiness is conformity to the character and the will of God. See, righteousness produces holiness. So righteousness is you saying, hey, you know what? I need to now do my part. I'm now realizing that what I was doing was sin before the Lord. And gradually you grow more and more and more and more and more. And there's a sanctified period that you go through. But I'm saying now, we are now in a period where Christians that smoke cigarettes, Christians that drink alcohol, Christians that dress like the world and come into the house of God, it is sin before the Lord. Because where in the past it was a common thing, God is saying now it is holy ground. And the church that wants to see revival is a church that's willing to change individually and become and raise the standard to where God is directing us. Because we are preparing this garment for the Lord in holiness and in righteousness. See, as he is, so are we in this world. So how he is, that's how we should be. But how many of us are being as he is in this world? It says here, holiness is being like Jesus. How many of us want to be like Jesus? How many of us want people to see Christ within us, the hope of all glory, where they see there's such a change and transformation that they know that God is doing something. See, holiness is a beautiful thing. Holiness is wonderful. And it is a pure grace that was given to us to be able to live holy lives and keeps a fresh fear of the Lord. See, when we look into a clear pond of running, streaming water, we see how beautiful it is to look to the bottom. We like to see that pure reflection of us looking into that beautiful, clear, crystal water. And so it is with us in this hour. God is calling us to come to another level. See, our holiness should be as what baptism is. See, when we get baptized, we are now making an open confession to everybody else around us. We're saying, you know what? It's now an outward evidence of an inward conviction. Is your outward evidence clear that Christ lives within you and He is holy? Are you preparing your garment? Are we preparing our garments? Are we now even changing our attire to say, you know what? In the past, I've been stubborn. In the past, I've been prideful because I didn't want to listen to that legalistic message. But how about you've got to now be told that now you've got to change to conform to the way that God is. See, when revival comes, it must bring a change. No more of these little movements of God where it's all focused on the manifestation of God, but rather than the holiness of God that brings change to the community. It brings change to that church. And that's one thing that I know, is genuine revival, the fruits of it will be, is one that's an awareness of God. There is an awe of God. There is no backsliding. There is such a change in the community that even the dress standard changes in the church. Now, we are now in an age where I don't think the church is dressed any more immoral than they have since the beginning. But we are saying, hey, you know what, it's all right, God just looks at my heart. Well, that might be right if you haven't been baptized, but if you've been baptized, then your outward evidence must also mean that you're living a holy life. Hallelujah. Or otherwise, you need to be re-baptized to make a fresh commitment to the Lord. That's why most people we do deliverance ministry with, we give them a 30-day plan to get their lives right with Christ. But I believe that every single Christian needs to do that 30-day plan. They need to re-look at their lives. They need to re-look at their wardrobe. They need to re-look at their movie collection. They need to re-look at their behavior. See, an outward form of an inward conviction. No matter who is around you, they will see it because everything changes in your life from the inside out. See, an inward conviction without an outward change on the outside will not change your dispensation to those around you, the disposition of those around you. As many things will speak of the reverence of the Lord to those around you. See, even your approach to people, your conduct, your dress code, your words and your humility, all those things must play a part in the change to who I was. So is God talking to us to come out of our comfort zones? He is, every single one of us. And I say that to myself, not to become legalistic and just put an outward form condition without an inward conviction. But I'm saying that God's word must penetrate in this hour. Because one thing that I noticed when I came back from Kenya after experiencing pure revival was the change that it created. Where I now knew under the conviction of the Holy Spirit, not based on someone else's experience and in their own minds of thoughts of speaking to angels or having heaven or hell experiences, but by my own conviction of the Word of God, that I knew something needed to change. Are we changing to prepare ourselves for that day? If we knew that we were going on a journey, we're going from one climate to another, do we change our clothes? When you go to some of the peaks in New Zealand and you know it's going to be snowing, and you're from a hot climate, like in like a humid climate, you're gonna have to change your climate. You're gonna have to change your climate to prepare yourself for that new place. And so it is here. We must start to change our attitudes. We must start to change the things that we do, our behaviors, even our attire, to prepare ourselves for that coming day of the Lord. Now, this might be a challenging word to each and every one of us, but if you're a Christian that has not been challenged about your smoking, about your drinking, and you're still doing those things, then what I'm saying is what God is saying in Psalm 55, verse 19. It says, affliction will come upon you because you will endure the tribulation. You will not be raptured because you are not willing to change. Now, those that come to this church, we've had so many people give up smoking. We've had so many people give up things, change the way that they dress, change their viewpoint on things, not because it was drummed in their head, but because they knew that something was changing in the hour. Something was changing, and God is holy. And it's not like what we see in the church. There's so many people that are preaching a message that tickles the ears of people because it keeps them in those comfort zones. You know, we were doing deliverance the other day. Even a demon spoke to us and said, you know what the tactic is against the church that preaches holiness and righteousness? It is that we will make people think that those people are legalistic. We will even make those people think that there is something not right about that person as though that they are possessed themselves. Hey, truly, this is a plan of the devil and it's being exposed right now. So if you're preaching holiness and righteousness, continue until the Lord comes. Are you preaching higher standards? Continue until the Lord comes. Because if you have a daughter and you say you're a little bit stricter than being lenient, it's better to be stricter than more lenient. Because the devil is a lion and he comes to rob, kill, and destroy. Hallelujah. So our own personal standards must be raised up. And must be raised up to a higher level as though we are preparing ourselves in a traditional garment as we see here. This is a traditional Victorian garment. God is even coming back for something so much more glorious than this. He's not coming back for a modern day church, by the way. He's not coming back for a modern day move of the Lord, where it's based on your selfish manifestation. No, he is coming back for a holy, pure bride that is going to bring a change in this community. Hallelujah. That the community are going to see that there is something different about them. It's something different. It's something different and pure. The amount of people that say to my wife, are you a Muslim? Because she covers her head, not just on Sunday, but every day. She says, no, I'm a Christian because I fear the Lord. Hallelujah. That's the standard. That's the change, the level of change that God is convicting us and challenging each and every one of us. He's challenging us. We're not saying you all have to do this, but what is God challenging on? Are you in your comfort zone? Are you being prideful? Because that spirit of pride will stop revival in your life. It will stop you even encountering the presence of God because you yourself can't get on your knees and repent and turn from your sins. God is looking for a humble heart in this hour. He's looking for those that will just repent. See, my past is such a wicked past that most people wouldn't know who I was. I was out there with bikie gangs, dealing drugs and even trying to get guns to people. Now all of a sudden God comes and changes your life. There is such a dramatic change that even the change starts to repel people. Even your own family are repelled by you because you no longer are of this world. And God says, if you're of the world, they will love you. But if you're not of this world, they will hate you just as they hated him. Hallelujah. We need to raise the standard in this hour. We need to walk in pure love like never before. Because there is a remnant of people that want to bring change. Hallelujah. We cannot look to those of the old anymore. But we must come back to the Word of God. We must focus our eyes on Israel and know that time is short, that Jesus is returning back soon, that all prophecies are being fulfilled every day. Are you going to continue to listen to those voices that are going to take you off the path? If any voice is telling you to come away from holiness and purity and high standards, run from that voice in this hour. Run from it. Run from that voice. Because they'll start to say, you know what, it's all right to get married again once you've been divorced and you're married in the church the first time. Oh, it's all right, you get married two or three times. That is a lie. God's standards are higher. Hallelujah. God's standards are pure and holy. God is looking for a pure church in this hour. Are we going to be that church? Are we preparing our garments? Is it evident? Is it so evident? You can see when someone's walking down the street and they're dressed modestly, you think, wow, as a saint of God, that is so refreshing to see. With all the other things that are happening in the world, it's refreshing to see someone that's willing to change. But when you go into churches these days and you see they're dressed just like the world, there is no change. And God is saying, because they did not change, they did not fear the Lord. Do we fear the Lord enough to change our garments? Enough to change the way we come? Hallelujah.